craziest experiences. I am bisexual. Sometimes I get crazy experiences with girls and crazy experiences with guys. I don't really trust men much, and I feel like I expect too much from them. That's probably my upbringing, but I expect a lot from them. And then with girls, I tend to, I'm the distant one. I'm the one that doesn't really care. I don't want to deal with you. You're being a girl. You're crazy. Like I think I just sabotage myself, honestly, either way.
I got married about 2.5 years ago. It was in April 2010. I've grown up my whole life with her. I mean, she's lived 3 miles up the road. I mean, ever since we were, I don't know, 5, 6. Her dad does all the chopping, harvesting for the farm. So, I mean, that's why we've been around each other for so long. I've been friends with her brothers for a long time. We dated for probably a year and a half, a little less than that. And then decided it was a good idea to get married. And it's just kind of funny because I always thought, even when I was dating all these other girls, I always went back to thinking I was going to marry somebody that I had known my entire life, but I could never pinpoint who that was. There was never a doubt in my mind about, was this the right idea? I knew it was the right idea.
I don't know if it's really healthy for people to string other people along and get emotionally involved and then just say that it was nothing. Whereas my parents, it was really obvious. Like, if a guy and a girl were going out and doing things together and kissing each other, then they were dating, and it was like really clear what was happening, and nobody would get confused, and now everyone's confused. The technology is enabling us to be cowards when it comes to relationships. And more than just romantic relationships, when it comes to conflict, it enables us to do things in a way that probably isn't the best way, rather than confronting someone face to face and having to look them in the eye and deal with the emotions that they are feeling. It's so easy to just say what you feel and not think about it and hit send. And it's easier to stalk someone on Facebook than it is to ask them questions about their life.
We only knew her for a couple months, and she said she was gonna have a baby. I was just starting college. I'm still in a halfway house. I still have a state number. Like, I'm still under the Department of Corrections custody. And I'm 20 years old. I'm still like a kid, you know? Like, I don't wanna have to raise a baby yet. If I have to and everything works out, I would love to. Right now, I don't have enough money to raise a kid. I mean, I could, but I wouldn't be able to give the kid what I had.
Right now, I mean, we're getting closer to getting into a relationship, so I usually say my girl, or I mean, I sometimes say friends with benefits.
We're exclusive, not official.
Right? It's just not Facebook official.
Well, he doesn't even have a Facebook, which is good, but I don't care about the Facebook officiality
she
of
does.
It. Well, that's a little bit, because after, you know, over two years of being single, after having to change that status, I just want to rub it in everybody's faces that told me, stop going for him, you're not going to get him. Just bam, in a relationship.
I'm about to get married in a couple months, so, you know, we're not going to have kids anytime soon, so we're going to have that. We feel like we have a window where we can go travel and explore and see the world. One day I sit in my dorm room and she was, I don't know, you know, I guess at her apartment or something, and we were messaging back and forth, and I was just like, so if I added you as my girlfriend on Facebook, and I like sent you a request, as you know, to say that you were my girlfriend, as my relationship status on Facebook, would you say yes? And so she said, of course I would. And so I sent it to her, and she said yes. And that's kind of how I started dating. And now that I say that story, it's kind of really sounds cheesy and kind of whatever. But I think that is kind of how our generation communicates and stuff. So
when he took me off like the relationship status, I cried. It was like, and we had left it up there for like a week. And that is so pathetic. It is this
crazy phenomenon, and I have fallen victim to it. Right now, at this point in my life, I'm 22 years old. I'm having a hard time deciding if I really want to be in a committed relationship and if I want to move in with my boyfriend, or if I could just spend the rest of my life being single and doing my thing and focusing on my career and the people I'm serving and my family. You know, there have been things in my life that have contributed to my lack of trust in men. And even in the relationship that I'm in now, I'm having a lot of trouble with it. And he is so wonderful in that he understands that this is going to take some time and that I have some phases that I need to go through, and he's being very patient.
Serial monogamy is the idea that people have a series of partners, and in each relationship they tend to be monogamous. They tend to be only with that one person. But these days there's not just one of those. There's a series of them, usually beginning in your late teens and for most people lasting at least until the late 20s. I think they're definitely stung, many emerging adults, by the kind of thing they've seen in their divorcing parents and their divorced parents. They talk about it a lot, and they talk about it really with remarkable bitterness, even 5, 10, 20 years later. They talk very passionately about not wanting to repeat that in their own lives and not wanting their own children to go through it. And it's quite touching, really, because I know statistically as a researcher that half of them are going to divorce. Whatever hopes they have, however determined they are, that's very likely what's going to happen. And yet none of them think that that's the fate that awaits them. They all are very determined to make it last.
For me, that was the norm for my parents to be divorced. It wasn't until I probably got to like high school that I started realizing that, you know, there are families where that's not the case and that, you know, it is a little different. I think the biggest thing that affects my generation with it is that this kind of negative outlook, I wouldn't say negative outlook, but less than promising outlook on the idea of marriage lasting and marriage being real or love being real or whatever, because you have a very high divorce rate, so people are just thinking that this must not be a feasible thing. I know a lot of people who are saying things like, yeah, I'm never going to get married, or I'm never going to have kids. A lot of young ladies that I know say that one, even though I don't think it's going to be true down the long stretch, but yeah.
Is it natural to want to take that sex that we have with a person and then want to connect it to something called a relationship? Like maybe something where we know, oh, this is a socially accepted, socially defined relationship. That's my boyfriend. That's my girlfriend. Is it natural to want to take that sex and connect it to a relationship? Show of hands, yes. Okay. Lots of people.
No, my students will say, oh, well, I read this thing. Well, I heard this thing about how most people are single and they're really happy about that. Is that really true? And what they're referring to, they'll send me a link, and what they're referring to is something that, you know, it's this long. It's two journalistic paragraphs. It's 8 to 10 sentences. But so clearly some of this information that could be relevant to young adults, it's on their radar. They click into it. They pay attention to it. They're getting the tip of the iceberg of information. And I think we need to keep ensuring that there are ways for them to get more information or to have more conversation about the implications of these little blips of information and ideas that are really relevant, and to say, okay, well, let's talk about what's the big picture.
I had a Facebook official boyfriend when I was a sophomore, and I actually went through a time period where I thought about it a lot. And I didn't want to do that. I didn't want to be thinking about guys. I didn't want to be like, oh, is that guy single? He's really cute. I wonder if I'll ask me on a date, or I wonder if I'll get my number. And so I actually fasted from dating for a semester. I read a devotional book while I did that, and it was just like a 40-day fast, and I just fasted for the whole semester. And so since that was a struggle for me, I didn't want to hang out with guys one-on-one, and unless I was specifically ministering to them, trying to show them what a woman of God looked like. And honestly, I think I realized it was after I left college when I really started going out on dates more, because I think when you're in college and you're surrounded by that group of friends, it's kind of like, it's weird to go out with guys in that group, just because it would be so much of a bigger deal than it has been now, you know, because people would blow it up like, oh, you're going out on a date, do you like him, does he like you? But really, dating is just going out and meeting people, you know. It's not any bigger deal than it should be, and I think in college it is a bigger deal.
I like to go on real dates where you really get a chance to do something extravagant. A lot of times with girls, they aren't sure if they want to go on the date with you, and you need to just go to like a happy hour or a bar or something like that. So of course it always depends on the situation, but guys like just get lazy, and so instead of working out in their mind how they can call them or talk to them or see them again, it's so much easier for them to just click on their name and chat with them. People let the status of the relationship be defined by Facebook and what options Facebook gives you for your relationship. A lot of times in relationships, there's like a dominant one and one who's not as dominant. And usually it's the dominant one who's afraid to broadcast to the rest of the world that they're in a relationship. You know, it totally cuts their ties off with all the other people they're trying to talk to. And so you see this kind of thing a lot. You know, it's almost a weapon sometimes, the relationship status of Facebook. Being from the Midwest, I think it's a little different here, whereas girls might be attracted to you because of your values or the way you were raised, and of course your physical appearance as well. Materialism, I don't see here as much. I struggle with talking about shallow things. A lot of times I go out with girls and they want to talk about magazines or something, and all I'm thinking about at that moment is, how can I change this conversation to something I want to talk about? So I don't want to get involved with a girl like that. I'd rather have a girl who challenges me, and I know that's the only kind of girl I'm attracted to, is a girl that challenges me. I have standards, maybe too high of standards of what I want in a girl, but I'd rather have that and not get married than to settle for someone less.
I'm in a relationship now, and her name's Amanda, and she's pretty wonderful. Her dad was in the military, so he's like high strung. There's none of that anywhere near my life. And he kicked her out, so she moved in with me, and it's just under such bad circumstances. We are awesome together, like we're perfect together, but under that time frame was pretty tough on her. And he's okay with me. I saw him at Christmas and he gave me a hug and I was like, whoa, I can't believe that. But he eased up a lot and it's starting to flow better with her too. I was like the most shy you could ever possibly imagine. And as I grew up, I started to like realize that there's a gap between me and everybody else, and I didn't understand why. So I was probably 17, I think, was my first like girlfriend. And I never was with a boy ever. Never had intentions to. But I had a pretty hard time with that. And then that's when in high school I really blossomed. Like I really like sprouted and I started to get along with a lot of people. And I don't know, my parents weren't very supportive at first. My mom, they are now, but my mom was really tough on me, and my dad was just kind of like, I just don't want to hear about it, not in the house. So that, like, once I came to terms with that in my whole entire life, it kind of like brought me out. Like, it's not just saying something, it's a lot more than that, and it completely unlocked this entire separate personality that never existed before.
People in my culture, in Mormon culture, we get married early, right? So I'm 23, and they're like, come on, John, you know, you gotta get on, kind of thing. It means finding missus who will put up with me for eternity. That's what it means, right? Marriage itself, you know, you'll throw it, especially here, you'll hear it in the Valley, marriage is a religious institution. It originally was. But I think any religious institution, any religious pattern of behavior, the core aspect of it is faith. It's the idea of believing is seeing, not the other way around, that you have to step into the dark and then you'll see what you're supposed to do. And so we've turned marriage, and I've become victim of this, we've removed the religious aspect of marriage, and we've turned it into a formula. And there's whole doctoral dissertations that are based on it. If you get this score, then you'll be happy with your spouse for this long based on these statistics and this and that, you know, and beautiful things. It's great. But ultimately, there's a faith component with any religious institution. That's what it's all about, is faith. So at some point, I have to make the decision and say, you know what? I'm just going to jump. Like in the movies, let's run away together, you know. Run away to Provo. I don't know. But you have to just exercise that faith and make that decision. That, you know what, I trust you with my life.